They look polarized. They're not polarized. Those would have been too expensive. But they look polarized.
Yeah.
And that's what counts, right?
Yeah.
And not only that, but they say truth on the side. And so when you're walking around and wearing them, and somebody's like, hey, why is truth on the side of your shades? Then, you know, just go ahead and drop a plug for Truth Baptist Church. That's the, you know, it's free advertisement, plus you get some good shades. So all the dads, all the fathers, this morning, if you would, on your way out, make sure you get you a pair. We should have enough for everyone. I think we're ready to move right into the worship service this morning. The kids have something they've been working on. So, kids, come on up. We're all going to gather on this side right over here. And y'all get set up and we'll sing.
My dad is stronger than Superman, smarter than Iron Man. He even drives a minivan. He teaches me to be the best I can. Oh, he is my very best friend. He is my very best friend. Yes, he is. He is my very best friend. Yes, he is. My dad is handy like the tool man. Mom had to call the fireman. The flames were really big, man. I hope knows that I am his biggest fan. Oh, he is my very best friend. He is my very best friend. Yes, he is. He is my very best friend. Yes, he is. My dad is as cool as the Kool-Aid man, even though he drives a minivan. I love him because he's a man. He tells me that God is the great I am. Oh, he is my very best friend. Dad, you are my very best friend. My dad is so smart, so strong, and so funny. There's nothing my dad cannot do. My dad fixes toilets. He's good with a hammer. There's nothing my dad cannot do. My dad snores really loud, takes up the whole couch. He eats all of my favorite foods. He shows me how to play ball, picks me up when I fall. He helps me with my homework, too. My dad is the best, greater than all the rest. There's nothing my dad cannot do. Dad, this is your day. What more can I say except how much that I love you? Dad, you are so smart, so strong, and so funny. There's nothing that I would not do for you.
Wonderful job, kids. Awesome, awesome stuff. I believe that the Owens family is going to be making their way up to sing as we continue with the worship service this morning. But if there are any testimonies this morning, don't sit on them. If you do have something to praise the Lord for this morning, you're not interrupting anything here. We would love to hear from you. So if any testimonies this morning as they're getting ready.
Calling, telling me how
Amen. Aren't you thankful God's in this story? Amen. Jess, she blew her voice box out there Wednesday night. Amen. I texted her yesterday, and she said she'd have them ready, and they're ready. They're always ready. Thank the Lord. Amen. Give these guys time to get to where they're going. We had a great time yesterday at Blast Zone, watching the Mario movie and eating all kinds of snacks. I want to say this. Those kids can put away some food. The popcorn was gone. I don't know what they did with the cheese, but the nachos cheese was gone. I mean, it was a canister that full and about that big around, and they just kept eating it. They weren't going home with me, so we just told them keep eating. Amen. We ate every snack cake cookie we had left, and they're gone to the glory of God, and I'm thankful for it, and thankful for the opportunity to allow that you allowed us to invest in your kids, and next month we're going to do it again. It's going to hopefully be, when you plan water events, it usually ends up being a rainy day, but we're planning on going outside and throwing balloons and shooting each other with water guns. You got to make sure you say the water guns nowadays because people freak out. But we're going to promote gun safety. Hey, ma'am, no shooting in the eyes. But we're going to have a good time with that and a bunch of other things the team has planned for the children. Make sure you bring them. Stick around if you want to. If you don't want to, that's fine. Just make sure you're back on time, and we've never had that problem, but as a youth pastor, we had it all the time. I don't know what it is about teenagers. They drop them off, and they don't ever want to come back to get them. Now, kids, they're like, I got to get my babies, so they're on time for babies, but we get them teenagers. I don't know what it is. Don't know what it is. Hey, do me a favor. My buddy, he's watching right now. He's going to have heart surgery this week. And I want you to pray without ceasing. Every time you think of Chris and Miss Shelley and their family, I want you to call on God. You don't have to get all eloquent and become something you're not. God didn't call you to be something you're not. Prayer ain't supposed to be something that you're not. You don't have to be 1600s version of who you are. You just be you and say, God, I'm begging you to fix my buddy. That's all you got to say. And go, as a church, I want us to go before the throne of grace and call on Jesus to fix this situation. And aren't you thankful to see Miss Shelley here today? Toughest person I know to put up with Chris as long as she has, but she's here today. Many of us would still be in bed, a wreck of ourselves, if we went through the same situation, but she got out of bed and come to church today. And give her a hand and say thank you for coming, Miss Shelley. Skip's here today, and his family went through a tragedy this week. You don't plan on what they went through. Nobody gets out of bed hoping to go through that situation. And he's here this morning and taught his Sunday school class. That's a big thing. That tells the devil, you can't have my family. And he's trying, but he ain't getting them. And we're thankful for you and your family. Let's give the Hudnall family a hand. I want to pray that you continue to pour out your love and affection on them in this time, not just this week. This week you're numb. Next week you start feeling again. And next week we need to really pour it on. And about this time next month, even more. And about this time next year, a little more. And matter of fact, I'm just going to go ahead and tell you this from experience. we just need to keep loving on them, because we're never going to understand. And we're never going to not feel broken. We're never not going to feel that the loss. What happens when you're mourning someone is it's always going on in the back of your mind. And out of nowhere, you can find a sock. You can have a smell. You can experience something. Somebody can cut you off on the side of the road, and all of a sudden it sends you into that time. And so you make sure you pray for your people. I'm broken today and have been since I got the phone call. It's just been a weird week for our church. I knew it was coming. You can't have what we've been going through and not experience this. You can't. We had an awesome week of revival. I told Daniel yesterday, could you have found another preaching style that we could have experienced in 1 week? I don't think it was possible. And the Lord just kept working and moving and blessing. And then he gave me a thought about Friday for this morning. I typed it up, had it ready to go. This is I'm going somewhere. And this is how the weeks went. I came in, I finished up, polished it, made it look nice and wonderful. It was a nice sermon. It was ready. And I clicked on the wrong button on my computer. It went away. And I Googled how to find it. And I couldn't find how to find it. So I typed out what I got, what the Lord gave me. There is no eloquence here. There is no extra stuff. Happy Father's Day. We're going to go with what God gave us, and we're not going to let the devil steal what we came here to do. That is to worship Jesus Christ, to glorify Him, and to grow in His grace. Aren't you thankful that we have somebody who can overcome the devil, somebody who can tell him to get behind us, somebody wonderful like Him? Let's look together in Matthew chapter number 8. Chapter number 8, verse number 5. And if you don't mind standing for the reading of God's word, I'll have you out of here very shortly. You'll have sunglasses on your face and food in your belly. Look, it says this: "And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion, beseeching him, and this is what he said, My Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented." Let me back it up. Say it again. He said, I got somebody at home going through it, and I came to you because at home something's going on that needs fixed. He said this, and Jesus said unto him, I will come and heal them. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the words only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this man, go, and he goeth. And I say to another, come, and he comes. And to another servant, do this, and he does it. And when Jesus heard it, look at this. When Jesus heard it, what's the Bible say? When Jesus heard this, one more time for the ones in the back, he marveled. He marveled and said to them that followed, Verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith. No, not in Israel. And he said that many shall come from the east and the west and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of this kingdom shall be the kingdom shall be cast into the darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said to the centurion, go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done. And the servant was healed the selfsame hour. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being so good to us. God, so much has happened this week. And for the very fact that we're standing and here is a testimony to your grace and goodness. Lord, I pray that you would meet with us today. Here on Father's Day, God, I pray that you'd pour out and move in a way that only you can. Lord, we'll give you praise and glory for it all because you're worthy of it all. Lord, I ask you to empty me of self and sin, fill me with your spirit because today it is the Super Bowl. And I pray that together, Lord Jesus, we leave no doubt. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. This past, thank you, sir, Monday, we played the Catholic team. They was the number one-ish team when they played us. And then they played us. And we did real good. And so we played these guys, and some things happened. We whipped them pretty good. They kept up with us for a minute, but, you know, it's just because we got bored and let our hair down. Amen. Say amen, guys. Amen. Finally, you know how to say amen. Remember to do that the rest of the sermon. But we was having ourselves a good old time. And our men, if you haven't been to a church softball game, come. We play, when is it, Tuesday night? We play to come. And just listen to Greg talk to everybody else. That's all you've got to. It's wonderful when Chaz gets up there and he said, come on, chili dog. Everybody, I mean, you could be the most depressed human being on the planet. And come on Tuesday night, and it'll change. I promise, it's good stuff. Well, so we had some things happen. It was a fun time. And one of the things that happened that really got me is a couple of throws. You know, when somebody really just lets loose and just, I mean, phew, throws a BB, it's impressive. It brings the man out of you. Like you're living vicariously through them, like, yes, my boy. So, Aaron's in left field, standing on top of the fence. At least in my mind, and I'll tell it this way forever. And, I mean, he just throws a frozen rope, meaning to throw it to the third baseman. He threw it home and canned the guy at home. And I was like, I'm going to use a Bible word. In the selfsame hour, Trevor gets him a nice little seed, comes in and it pops up into his glove. He tosses it over to Bill. Bill goes, boom, and hits me. I mean, my hand hurt. And I said, man. Did you see the cannon on that man? In fact, I took my gun and turned it into a radar. Y'all ever seen the movie Major League? I know it's holy. Amen. Where he slaps it and it turns to 99. I slapped my glove and was like, 99 miles an hour. I mean, that thing was cooking and I just thought, man. Matter of fact, I said this. I said, my. I sat there in wonder at what I just seen. It's amazing. We see stuff like that all the time. I want you to look at verse number 10. In verse number 10, my moment happens. Listen, the Bible says that this man came from Capernaum. And he came down, this centurion, this man of valor and might, this warrior came into where Jesus was. And the Bible says that he came and asked him to do something in his home. Well, they had a conversation, and in the end of that conversation, the Bible says, and when Jesus heard, that means all the stuff before that is what Jesus heard. When he heard what he heard, the Bible says that he marveled. Do you see that? He marveled. You say, preacher, what does marvel mean? It means to stand in wonder. To look at what just happened, to hear what just happened and say, my, I've never seen something like that. My, I've never heard nothing like that. I started thinking about that. And you know this, that there's a lot of times in the four Gospels, there is a lot of times when people marveled. That they marveled at Jesus whenever he healed the blind man. They marveled at Jesus whenever he took the deaf man and gave him hearing again. And he took the lame man and made him walk again. They marveled at the miracles that he did. And they marveled at Jesus whenever he would stand and speak and tell them things that they never heard before. And they would begin to say, my, we've never heard anything like that. When Jesus stood up on the ship and he looked at the wind and the waves and he said, be still. They said, my, I've never seen nothing like that. Whenever, oh, Lord of God, I'm feeling pretty good now. Look, he said, whenever Jesus come walking on the water and he come back into the ship, the boys were in the back talking and they said, my, I never seen nothing like that. When Jairus' daughter was dead and gone, having everything taken from the man who had little faith, Jesus came in and healed that little girl and brought her back to life. I believe Jairus looked at his wife one day and said, my, I ain't never seen nothing like that. When Lazarus was dead and gone, the world looked on and said, there is no hope left. There is no. His sister said, he stinks. He's been in there so long. His other sister said, if you'd have been here, Jesus, there ain't no way he'd be dead. And then all of a sudden, Jesus said, Lazarus, come forth. He come walking out of the grave. I just believe this, that everybody that stood on said, my, I ain't never seen nothing like that. Over and over in the New Testament, we find that when people looked on what Jesus did, they marveled at what they saw and what they heard. I wonder, have you looked in your life and seen how marvelous he is? Oh, how amazing. But do you know this? In all four Gospels, Jesus only marveled two times. In all the four Gospels, you'll only find the word marveled used two times. One is here in Capernaum. The other is in Nazareth. In Nazareth, we find that Jesus is talking to his own people, to his family, to his friends, to those that are in the community, those that watched him grow up. And he said, I've never seen such disbelief before. He said, I've never seen such faithlessness before as the group of people that I'm supposed to be surrounded with, that I grew up with. But now he's in Capernaum. And he says, I've never seen faith like this. In Nazareth, the Bible says that he could not do many works there because of their disbelief. He could not heal. He could not cause blindness to go away. He could not, because they had no faith. But here in Capernaum, we find a man who Jesus looked at and said, I've never seen faith like this. This kind of faith. And because he saw this kind of faith, in the very few verses later, I believe it's verse 13, we find that he says, go on home, believing the same way that you believed when you came, and watch as you see the servant healed. He was able, he was able to work a miracle because of the faith that was marvelous. But over here, they had a marvelous kind of disbelief that could not see faith or something happen. Let me say this. Let me break it down, what I'm getting at. We're not seeing what we could see because we're not as faithful. We're not possessing the same faith that we need to see the miracle. And I don't know about you, honey, but I've decided today on Father's Day, I want to be a man that when Jesus looks at, he goes, my. I've never, did you just look at the faith on that one? That boy's got some faith. Hey, listen, I want to be somebody that has faith that Jesus marvels at. I wonder today, is there anybody who's with me that says, I want that kind of faith today? I want the faith that God himself incarnate looks at and says, that's the kind of faith a man needs. Do you want it today? You say, preacher, how do I have that kind of faith? I want to give you two truths today, and we'll get our sunglasses and go home. Look at verse number 6. It says this in verse 6, and saying, Lord, my servant he layeth at home sick of the palsy, grievous. Do you notice what he did when he came to Jesus? He stated his problem. He came to Jesus recognizing his need. He had a real problem. If you're writing it down, number one, by taking ownership of your real problem. You see, a lot of the problems that we have today are really what the older generation calls responsibilities. Can I get a witness? Those who have no hair or is gray in the beard, can I get a witness? The people in this generation coming up now, the problems that they have are really what's called responsibilities. Ooh. I'm going to put it in four-wheel drive. I feel like something needs run over a few times and flattened out. Amen? You see, in this generation, we take the responsibilities that we've been given as just basic breathing people and say it's hard. I ain't making no friends today. It's hard to go to work. All you did was slap the alarm clock, put some clothes on, you didn't even fix your hair, and you went in. How hard is that? Oh, but it was hard. Drink another cup of coffee. Suck it up, buttercup, and get to work. But I got a cold. Ladies and gentlemen, this ain't COVID no more. Go to work. I don't want to give nobody my cold. They don't care about your cold. They care if they have to do extra work because you laying in bed with a cough. Anybody with me? Amen. It's a responsibility. We break down. Listen, we know we got bills. Help your preacher now. I hope you know you got bills. We know we've got bills. They come once a month. It shouldn't be a surprise to you that you have to pay your electric bill. It's a responsibility. You don't have to go to Jesus and say, Lord God, those people down at that evil, lost, addicted world called the electric company, sending power my way every time I want to turn the light switch on. Why is it that they keep sending me bills? Oh, God, will you do something about this electric bill? No, it's your responsibility. If we don't have a generation of people who finally get up off their tail end and say, I've got some responsibilities, I'm tired of dodging them, we're going to sink in the sinkhole of life and helplessness. We're all going to be depressed. We're all going to have anxiety. We're all going to be a hot mess. Come on, people. It's time that we decide that we're not going to take our responsibilities and pass them to everybody else in our life. You see, this was not, like, listen, this was not a responsibility. This was a real problem. Preacher, how do I know what the difference between a responsibility and a real problem is? A responsibility is something that you can maintain throughout the time and will not affect your family and your home. A real problem is something that pops up and turns your family upside down. Can a responsibility become a real problem? Absolutely. When you don't pay attention to your responsibilities, they'll turn into a real problem. Oh man, I'm having so much fun, even if nobody else wants to have fun with me. Look, y'all's praying, Lord God in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us our preacher back a computer that doesn't delete his sermons. You see, this man identified, he understood what was going on in his home because he was taking care of the responsibilities in his home. You see, you know why? Let me tell you like this. There was a man who went 1 week without cutting his grass, 2 weeks without cutting his grass, 3 weeks without cutting his grass. Anybody know anybody like that? 4 weeks without cutting his grass. And he sent his dog out to do his business. The dog was out there. A snake come up and bit him like Forrest Gump on the buttocks. Bit him good. He didn't know what was wrong with the dog. He just seen the whelp and he heard the whelp and he looked at the dog and he said, oh, poor doggy, what is wrong with you? And he took the dog to the vet and it said it's been bit by a copperhead. And within hours, that dog died because of a snake bite. The man said, I had no idea I had a snake in my garden or in my yard. He looked out and he saw the grass and he said, there's no way I could have saw it coming. You know what he did? Lawnmower won't cut that. He had to go out there with a weed eater and cut down all the weeds that had grown up in his yard. Now it's hard to get your, listen, it's hard to get your dog back when you wait till after it's bit to cut your grass. You see, if we don't start picking up our responsibilities and doing the little things when the big things happen, we're going to go, how did we get here? This man knew in his home that there was a hot mess taking over, and he could have been like, it's just a servant, if he didn't know the servant. It's just another person who works for me, if he didn't know that everybody in his family liked the servant and the servant was valuable to his home. So he said, because this one has value to my home, I need to do, if there's going to be something that happens, I'm going to be the one that has to do something about it. If change is going to take place in my home, I'm going to be the one who has to travel the distance to seek change. Ladies and gentlemen, men, fathers, husbands, if you don't decide in your heart today to say, my family's worth walking for, my family's worth going the distance for, nobody else is going to care. Society doesn't care about your family. Society doesn't care about your marriage. The White House could care less about anything that you have going on. The only thing that you got going for you right now is Jesus Christ is walking around your community. Will you come out of your house and take your real problems and lay them at Jesus' feet and say, Jesus, I need you to take this real problem. We need to own our problems. You say, what will happen? Jesus will say, my. I've been waiting for somebody who did the homework and found a mess and take the mess to me. And then look, number two, I got one for you. Look at verse number 8 and 9. I'm almost done. I still got some minutes. It says the centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof. Jesus said, I come to your house and fix this situation. He said, no, I'm not worthy. But speak the words only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority and have soldiers. They come when I tell them to come. They go when I tell them to go, and they do what I tell them to do. This man understood his position in life. Number two, if you're writing this down, how can someone be a person Jesus marvels at? Number two, by resigning your position. He knew exactly who he was. Look, you say, prove it to me, preacher. I like when you get snide with me and tell me to prove it. Because look at this. The Bible says this. He understood fully his position. Number one, he understood his spiritual position. Jesus said, I'm going to come into your house and I'll heal him. He said, no. You can't come to my house. I'm not worthy for you to come as holy as you are, as sinless as you are, as wonderful as you are. I'm not worthy of you coming to me. But I believe that you have the power to go across distance and make change. I'm just asking you to do something. You don't have to come to me. He understood spiritually he wasn't good enough. Jesus. I don't think anybody really gets what I'm saying here. Because this yuppie society, oh, this is fun. I'm going to go without notes more often. This yuppie, broke society, woke society, you want me to go on? Everybody love everybody. Everybody calls you friends. No, I don't got that one. We gotta massage everything. We gotta apologize for everything. So the fact that we can say that we're not worthy goes against everything in our society. Because our society says you're accepted. Everybody has to accept you. And you don't have to better yourself because they just got to love you for who you are. This ain't popular. No, this ain't going to get much shares on Facebook today. There ain't no thumbs up flying. Hey, look at my man in the back throwing them up. Praise God. You say, preacher, where are you going with this? I'm going to say this. There ain't none of us worthy of Jesus. We are all born sinners, broken, hopeless. Listen, I'm telling you the truth. There ain't nothing good about us. But he comes to Jesus. And in spite of, listen, Jesus knew. Jesus knows everything. He looked at him and said, I know you ain't good enough. But I didn't ask you if you was good enough for me to come into your house. I said, I will come. You see, he understood where he was standing. He admitted he knew where he was, that he was a sinner. And because of that, he could see a miracle in his life because he knew the status that he had in front of the... You say, what happens? What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying this, that we all need to acknowledge that we have to resign our spiritual position to Jesus Christ, the one who is perfect, who is good enough, who is worthy. We've got to take our broken condition, our helpless condition, and say, at your feet, Jesus, this is yours. That's not popular, because last time I checked, everybody is perfect. No one in here has ever sinned. Matter of fact, I'm looking for some of you to stop using 34th Street Bridge and just walk across it. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to keep writhing over it. Because I know this, I'm not worthy of this. But I'm thankful that in spite of my worthlessness, Jesus can still work with me. Look at this. I'm going to give you another one. Because verse number 9 still exists, so we got to do something with it, right? For I am a man under authority. I have soldiers under me. He said, I am under authority, but there's some under my authority. You see that? This man is a centurion. That means this, that he is one who has 100 men under his authority. And it is a part of a bigger group called a legion. This legion will mount up together in times of war and will go out and dismember and dismantle every army that they would face, and they would just whip people and take over their kingdoms. And when they did that, they would leave a centurion, a one who would govern the area. And he and his troops would be the law in the community. This man was the law. When he spoke, people listened. He did not go to people in that community. They came to him. Let me say that again so you can get the full impact. He never went to anyone. They came to him. But he recognized his position. Was just a worldly spot, and that there was somebody who come in his area who had more authority than him. And if he was going to see real change in his life, he was going to have to take his authority and knock it down a few notches and come humbly to the one who has all authority if he was going to see real change. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to be somebody who Jesus marvels at, you need to be somebody who gets out of his authority and get, or out of your authority and applies his authority. We have family movie night once a week. You say, well, that's just not holy. I don't care what you think. They're my kids. We watch the dumbest stuff. We watched Clifford the Big Red Dog 4 weeks in a row. You don't like Clifford the Big Red Dog, you ain't going to heaven. Amen. We watched Clifford the Big Red Dog. And so I'm in the other room popping popcorn. And my kids like to pick on me. They do. They get it from the mama's people. Amen. And they sit in my chair. Y'all ever been, y'all sit in your daddy's chair? And they sit in my chair, both of them. And I'm fixing popcorn for them. Because I got adult braces. I can't eat popcorn. Proof, thank you for praying for me. I need it. I've lost weight because I can't eat what I want to eat. Amen. 5 more weeks. So I come in the door carrying their popcorn, and I look down at them, and they just, their eyes are forward. And I know they're just trying to pick on me, so I look over them and I say, and they just start laughing. And Titus jumps up, and he moves across the room because he's super serious. And Ava looks up and goes, and I said, get out of my seat like that. I'm just joking. Don't get mad. I didn't beat her. Have you seen that girl? She's hard to beat. I said, get out of my seat. She goes, gets up, moves out of my seat. And I sit down. He said, what happened there, preacher? They recognized that authority came in the room, and they were sitting in his seat. And we couldn't start the movie until they got out of my seat. So I sat down. And I had, Brother Anthony, you know all about this. You know all about this. 3 seconds later, I've got this giant of a 9-year-old crawling up on top of me and this 5-year-old girl with all kinds of hair in my face. And I watched, you know this, you watched the whole movie through little peepholes. Listen, I've got something good for you. When they got out of my seat, I could sit down in it. Things could start. But then, they couldn't sit in my seat, but I had a place for them. And they could crawl up. They could crawl up on my lap when Ursula comes out. They could crawl up on me when they want to go real far, when Jafar comes in. When Scar starts roaring, they can crawl all the way up to my head. When things get weird and crazy and chaotic, there's a place on the Father's lazy boy of life where every one of us can find a place. I don't know about you. I didn't have that wrote down. It just came to me. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful that I got out of his seat, let him sit down, and he said, come on up to my lap. We'll go through some scary stuff together, and don't worry, son. I'll make sure that you're safely and soundly in my lap through it all. How many's thankful for a God like that this morning? I want to be a man, a person, a father, a husband. Jesus up in heaven looks over at the Father. He says, my. Have you seen that boy down there on 1061 Fairhaven? I'm giving you all my addresses. 1061 Fairhaven Drive. Have you seen him down there? My. Did you see that one down there on Chesterfield Avenue? He's dumb as a box of rocks, but he's dumb for me. Man, I don't know who you are today. But I do know this, that there's some real problems in this room. Big ones. And Jesus is ready to marvel at your life and see your faith. How do I exercise it, preacher? Number one, get out of his seat. Let him sit down and crawl up in his lap and let him work through this. Come by faith, believing he can and he will. With every head bowed and every eye closed, would you just look at the faith of these people? Look at the faith of that church. Look at the faith of that mom. Look at the faith of that dad. Look at that faith of that grandma and grandpa. Look at the faith of that husband. Look at the faith of that wife. Would you just look at it? That daughter, that son, that aunt, that uncle. Look at that faith. God says, man, I've never seen nothing like it. Really look at our lives and say, I could have did a lot of stuff. I could have worked a lot of miracles. I could have done a lot of something with them people. But they just didn't believe. They didn't have the kind of faith that I needed to do what I needed to do. I don't know about you today, but I want to grab on to that kind of faith. If you're here today and you say this, preacher, I don't know if I've ever been saved. But I'd like to know. I want to lift my hand and say, I don't know if I've ever called on Jesus as my Savior. Here's my hand. Will you pray for me? Amen. Maybe you're here today and you say, preacher, I know that if Jesus comes or I should die, I'm ready to meet him. Here's my hand. Will you give testimony to that today? Just lift it high. Amen. Maybe you're here today and you say, preacher, I want to have the faith that Jesus marvels at. Here's my hand. Will you pray for me? Amen. Preacher, will you pray for me that I accept the responsibilities in my life? Here's my hand. Amen. Preacher, will you pray for me that I take my real problems to Jesus? Here's my hands. Oh, wow. Preacher, will you pray for me that I take my position, give it over to him, sit down on his lap? Here's my hand. Amen. So many hands around this room raised this morning. Now, you've got to make a decision. Will you live in Nazareth with unbelief? Or will you walk in Capernaum and walk to Jesus? I wonder how many people, this one's already come, will come down to this altar and call on Jesus and say, I'm bringing it to you. I'm having faith in you today. I resign it over to you today. My problems are your problems. My pain is your pain. My responsibilities, I put them in you. I call on your name, Jesus, today to put it all under your authority. These have come. How about you? I want that kind of faith. My. Look at that faith. These have come. How about you? Maybe you're one of those that raised their hand or sat there and didn't know if they should raise their hand and step out of their seat tonight, come down to this altar and find Jesus as your Savior. You say, preacher, I don't know if I've ever been saved. This would be a good time for you to come and find him. Just simply step out of your seat, come down here, and we'll pray with you. Thank you. thank you for this day. Thank you for being so good to us. We thank you for your word and what it means to us. Lord, I pray that this sermon hit where it needed to hit in the way that it needed to hit. God, where my insufficiencies were taken by your all-sufficiencies, where my lack of knowledge was taken over by you who has all knowledge. Now, God, I pray that you would continue to work and pour out your blessings in our lives. Lord, I pray that you touch the fathers in this room, because our nation needs more daddies, ones that don't model themselves like the world, but model themselves like you. Like you who gave your life for the church, we would give our lives for our families. Lord, we love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Do want to take just a few minutes just to make a couple of announcements. We have, it's tomorrow, ladies, Bible study at 5:30, and then it's y'all at 8. 8 o'clock for True Freedom Bible Study Group. Come to one of those in the next few weeks. We're going to have more Bible studies rolling around, or connect group is what we're going to call them. Don't forget about the food baskets. Right now, the men are supposed to be bringing soup, and the ladies dollar bills, y'all. And y'all know where to put that. Let's see, is there other announcements? I don't know. See Miss Jennifer today, if you or somebody, tell them that you want to work in the Bible school, right? Everybody should do something in the Bible school, even if it's just security, because we are in the middle of Canal City, and we'll take every man who has hair on his chest that will just stand there and go, "You ain't touching our babies." Amen? We'll put you to work. Just look at them mean. This generation, that's really all you got to do. Just look at them mean. Clap your hands. Go, yeah. They'll do, yeah, it's all you got to do, the sissies. Back in my day. Sissies. We do have these wonderful, awesome sunglasses that we're going to give you guys on the way out. Brother Chaz, will you do me a favor? In my office, there's a basket as soon as you go through the door. Chaz is going to be the man. You get, you for helping me, you get a pair of glasses, all right? And just see Chaz on your way out the door. Grab you a pair of glasses. Today, if there's anybody, I'm going to take these off. If there's anybody who would like to talk, I'm going to stay up here today just to help the flow, because I know everybody's got some. Dad's a grilling somewhere, or y'all's going out to eat, so I'm going to give you space. But if you'd like to talk to me, I'll be up here. Brother Daniel will be around. We would love to talk to you. If you're here today and you have any questions about our church, about salvation, about baptism, about joining the church, just come see us. We would love to talk to you. We love you. We're thankful for you. I'm going to ask Brother Caleb to pray for us today, and while he's praying, I want to ask the parents who's got kids downstairs. One representative of a family would run downstairs and grab your babies, just to be responsible. So, brother, go ahead and pray. Give them a good long minute and a half prayer.